I will call to order this regularly scheduled meeting of the Board of Education, which was duly noticed on April 10th, 2015, through posting and notification of the press in accordance with Wisconsin Statute 19.84. Our first item, we have Grace Kabbalah and Genevieve Church with our Pledge of Allegiance. They're from Marshall Middle School.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Like the way you think? He said, go Cardinals. Hey. Our next item is consider approval of the April 14th, 2015 Board of Education agenda. Motion by Commissioner Soderman, second by Commissioner Shelley. The board should vote. And that passes. Oh yeah, you are on yes. Both of you on yes.
Wait, I'm on yes.
We're yeah. both on yes.
I see. I see. So
try no one.
Oh.
Okay, that's Dale's. Okay, now I'm on this. No. Wait a minute. If you've got mine and I've got yours.
Oh, wait.
Look at that.
Now, just let me vote on both of them. Little sucker here.
Double the power.
Okay, but still.
Go to abstain ones.
I'm on yes.
No, I'm on abstain now. Now it's affirmative, so.
Okay, so we're wired backwards.
Dale, go to abstain.
Wired it.
Abstain.
One more. Okay.
Abstain is yes.
So that passes unanimously. Okay. Well, either that or I will just do a roll call vote and not worry about that.
She can challenge her vote.
Okay, next is our safety message, Dr. Cargill.
Tonight's safety slogan, don't get caught in the web of unsafe acts. Don't get caught in the web of unsafe acts.
I won't even add anything to that one. Next is our evidence-based leadership message. Principal from Monroe Elementary School, Sally Pope.
Good evening. Thanks for having me here this evening. Do you remember the first time that you received a ribbon or a medal as a young child? Do you remember the sense of pride and accomplishment that you felt when you received that medal? And I bet you couldn't wait to get home and share that medal with your mom or your dad or another loved one and share your excitement with them. 16 students feel that way every morning on Monday mornings at Monroe Elementary School. Students who follow the PBIS Mustang Manners are recognized on our Monday morning live broadcast of announcements, and they receive a Mustang medal to take home and share with their families. This type of positive feedback at Monroe has allowed us to achieve a score of 4.72 on the parent satisfaction survey for the question, "My child is recognized for good work and behavior at this school." To date, Monroe Elementary has had 1,756 positive contacts home to our parents. We know that research shows that positive recognition and feedback to students can develop a feeling of competency, develop an increase in intrinsic motivation, and can even have positive effects on reading and math achievement. At Monroe, we believe in reinforcing the positives and recognizing hard work and behavior. After all, everyone likes to hear when something's going right. We thought it was only fitting that we recognize all of you who serve tirelessly on our school board here at the School District of Janesville. So I present each of you tonight with your very own Mustang medal that mirrors the ones that our students receive. It reads, Commissioner DeStefano is one of the School District of Janesville Mustang Medal winners. Your commitment to our students and families does not go unnoticed. Mrs. Pope and the Monroe Elementary staff. I expect this to be on all of your refrigerators. You send it in email form to your grandparents or kids. They'd like to see it.
May this positive recognition and feedback carry you through the rest of this evening's meeting and beyond. Thanks you for all you do for the School District of Janesville.
Well, that was outstanding. Can't help but everybody's smiling. That's pretty good. Well, and it appears that Commissioner DeStefano and Commissioner Schilling have a few bigger smiles, recognizing that this is our last meeting for the current board. Now is an opportunity to recognize Commissioner DeStefano and Commissioner Schilling. And I think first I'd like to, I don't know if there's anything any particular board members would like to say in relation to either one of them. Commissioner Hesselbacher.
I just want to thank you for your 3 years of service and recognize that you served as Finance Committee Chair, Benefits Committee Chair. As Chair of a committee myself, I know that that can sometimes take up a lot of extra time, so I appreciate all the time and effort that you both put into your service here. Thank you.
Anyone else? Mr. Soderman.
It's only 3 years, but what you did will go on for decades. Think of the path, the benefits changes, changing to the being insured by a company versus self-insured, and Dave, how even when the election turned out against you, you still came through with the proposals and to the end. So it was a lot of class, and I admire that. So this will be a long-felt benefit for the district. Gonna miss your expertise on those things, the acronyms that I didn't know for insurance. Deb, finance chair work, thank you very much. You're supposed to take it another year though, but you didn't, and so I was filling in. So again, thank you for the effort, and again, it'll take decades that you had an effect on the district.
Anyone else? Commissioner Myers.
Well, I don't know if I could, you know, I just want to sort of reiterate what has been said before. And it's been a lot of fun getting to know you. And really glad that we've had this opportunity to get to know you as, you know, board members and socially a little bit when we're not in a meeting, which is not, you know, often, but but it's been wonderful getting to know you. Thank you.
Yeah, first to Commissioner Schilling, I'd say didn't know you before we ran 3 years ago, and it was great getting to know you. It was great having another champion for safety. So I'm proud that I was able to serve with you, and I wish you well. And Commissioner DeStefano, I have known you for quite a while now from the Boundary Lines Committee, and our work actually is coming to fruition today later in the meeting, but it's been a complete honor. I appreciate your visionary efforts as I think of the Benefits Committee. And as we talk through that and your leadership there, it will definitely be missed. And thank you very much. Okay. Dr. Shelton?
Well, tonight, we are taking a moment to honor two of our outstanding commissioners. And we started a year ago with then Commissioner Felt to, on behalf of administration, show our appreciation. So I'm going to start with you, Commissioner DiStefano. Come on up. Thank you. Dave, your work on the PPC committee, Finance, Building and Grounds Committee, and as chairperson of Benefits was truly amazing. You connected us with excellent consultants, and you helped the district climb out of a deep, deep hole. You helped all of us have a better understanding of insurance, and your leadership in this area and many areas was truly appreciated. You never shied away from asking those hard questions, banging on my door when you needed something. Persistence is a strength of yours. And truly assisting me with the hard work of running the district. You gave us hours of service in which we can never repay. You also shared your delightful children and family with me, and they are such an asset to our district. I hope you all stay involved and that we see you around again. We'd like to present this to you, Board Commissioner David DiStefano, for your dedicated service to our children and community. We are what we repeatedly do. Excellence, then, is not an act, but a habit.
Thank you.
Commissioner Schilling, come on up. You have your acceptance speech ready. I feel like I'm giving out an Oscar. You have a way of seeing the world that is very unique and different. You brought to the board an analytical mind and a razor-sharp wit that I got to enjoy many times. As chairperson and a member of Finance, Building and Grounds Committee, you kept the focus where it needed to be, making sure our buildings were properly maintained and that the budget was closely followed. Not an easy task. You took time to understand the budget process, and you worked with us to find solutions to difficult budget issues. As a commissioner, you also focused on student achievement and making sure all students received those rich comments on their standard-based report cards. You two have shared your wonderful children with me and your family, and I'll be watching their successes as they grow up in our school district. As you leave the board tonight, you should be proud of the progress the district has made under your leadership. Thank you.
Well, Commissioner DiStefano.
Well, first of all, I just want to thank the board. It's been my pleasure the last 3 years. Just looking out, you know, I think I voted with and against every single one of you on different issues. You know, I've learned a whole bunch in these 3 years. They've been very enjoyable. Somebody who grew up in Janesville and graduated from Janesville, Craig, I kind of feel like now I'm just a Janesville graduate because I really root for Craig and Parker. And there's nothing better than when you see kids accomplish things. So you really feel a sense of pride. So I'll miss that, and I wish everyone well. So thank you.
I want to start off with thank you. Before I ran for school board, I had no idea the time commitment involved. So everybody, you know, thank you for putting in the time commitment and matching or exceeding what I was doing to make me feel like I wasn't alone. keeping that in mind, I had always hoped I would make more of an impact on the District of Janesville. I did not propose staff parking or anything that's more memorable. But I did want to leave not so much with what I did and what I got out of this, is what I'm asking of you as a group to go forward. As a group going forward, I ask you to continually look at what's right for the district. Put aside political affiliations, beliefs, union affiliations, beliefs, friendships, anything you have outside, and look at the district for the district. Really look at what's right for it, because your political beliefs may not align with what's right for the district. Your union beliefs may not align with what's right for the district. The union will fight for what's right for the union, and that may or may not align. Same with your political beliefs, friendships, anything along those lines. So I ask you to work on this board as an independent mind, analyze it, and take it forward, and really look into what's right for the district and not individual beliefs within it, because they are not mutually exclusive and they are not always in the best interest of both parties. So, thank you.
Okay, next, we'll hear from our student presenters to the board. From Parker High School, Sarah Dryden.
Hi everyone, I'm from Parker High School, Sarah Dryden, and I'm gonna give you an update on what's going on at my school. So spring has sprung at Parker High School and the falls are full of activity. Some of the things going on this month include that this week SLC is hosting Words Matter Week, and this event focuses on sharing positive words with peers, encouraging others, and pointing out the positives that happen at Parker High School. Compliments are being posted on the lockers in the halls for students to view. Yesterday, National Honor Society partnered with the Red Cross and held a spring blood drive. Over 105 students participated in this event. This past Saturday, the Parker Closet hosted its annual prom turnaround. This event helps out students with getting dresses for prom, altering them if necessary, and making sure that everyone can participate in the event. This year's prom will be held at on Saturday, April 25th at the Armory, and this year's theme is a crystal ball. Parker High School Choir is proud to announce that the selection of Emily Wagner and Jacob Schmidt for the 2015 Wisconsin Honors Project Mixed Choir. They were among more than 2,500 students from across Wisconsin to audition for a spot in one of these groups. The Honors Project is sponsored by the Wisconsin School Music Association, and this event brings together the best musicians from Wisconsin schools to work with the finest college conductors from the United States. We also have 15 students in choir that will be going to state solo ensemble later this month. Parker's Distinguished Vikings induction will be held on May 15th, and this year we are honoring 4 Parker graduates. 10 DECA members will travel to the International DECA this month to compete in a variety of marketing competitions. Our students have been preparing their business marketing plans, speeches, and materials for this event. The Parker FFA will be holding its annual plant sale at the end of the month. Our greenhouse is bursting at the seams with flowers, vegetables, and hanging baskets. Our adaptive tech ed class is also making garden ornaments to sell to fund their annual Trees for Tomorrow field trip to Eagle River in May. Also, Parker Robotics competed in Ohio and Cincinnati over spring break, and despite the fire on the robot during the competition, the team was able to put it back together, return to competition, and secure a 26th spot for the competition. Our team is already planning next year's competition. Spring sports are in full force also, and this week our baseball, soccer, track, and golf teams are participating. We have a record number of participants this year. Thank you, everyone.
Commissioner Dahmershausen?
Yeah, I have a question. How do you fund the DECA trips? It must be, you must have some kind of a fundraiser or something?
I'm not sure. The DECA itself might do a fundraiser, but I'm not part of that, so I'm not sure.
Go ahead. Mr. DeStefano?
I can tell you that Parker held a fundraiser at Max last night.
Oh.
But I think that there's more to come. So I saw that on Facebook, actually.
Thank you. Dr. Schulte.
I can add a little bit more. They certainly do a number of fundraisers. They do ask for donations from businesses as well. And then when I have money in my discretionary fund to also help them out, I certainly do that.
Okay. Thank you. Next, from Craig High School, Sam Brennan.
Good evening, members of the school board. Even with spring break occurring, the past few weeks have been very busy for Craig in almost every aspect. To start off, let's talk sports. And Commissioner DeStefano, I know you said that you root for Craig and Parker both, but this week you might want to stick with the Cougars. First off, our boys varsity baseball team ousted Parker boys 9-2, and girls softball sailed to a 19-5 win over the Westsiders. So I hold my gaze. In track, two record-setting relay runners are returning, so we look to be ahead this season. Our boys varsity lacrosse team is coming off a doubleheader winning weekend with wins over DeForest and Madison Westside. Craig sports are certainly in full swing. In academic news, I have much to cover as well. We held our academic recognition ceremony last month, in which we are proud to say 399 students qualified for. Parent-teacher conferences were also held, and parents were asked to take a survey on how our school was doing, from their point of view. This survey, along with our Cougar School Improvement Team meetings, are just a few ways we are making Craig better day by day. The Cougar School Improvement Team meeting for students will be held next week, and the meeting for parents will be on May 2nd. Everyone is encouraged to come. Also coming up will be our Aspire testing for current sophomores and freshmen. Last week, Dr. Beyond took six girls to the YWCA Women of Distinction Dinner, who exhibited excellence in both academics as well as athletics. As most of you know, our own Betsy Ennis won the Young Woman of Distinction Award herself. That very same day, Craig hosted our annual honor roll ceremony. We inducted well-known Janesville educator and tennis icon Camilla Owens, leader and military commander Marine Gunner Alex Carrillo, and physicist Dr. Edward Kreutz. I had the pleasure of researching and presenting Dr. Kreutz myself, who played a very important role in the secret government program, the Manhattan Project, where he worked alongside the one and only Albert Einstein. Isn't that just astounding? I think it's pretty cool that Janesville Craig High School, Janesville High School, alumni was placed right along a man who was well regarded as one of the brightest minds in history. We also can be proud of Craig Senior Maggie Gorman, whose design was chosen to be the city by the city council to be the official flag of Janesville. So whenever you see our city's new flag waving in the breeze, you have the creativity of one of our own students to thank. There are many upcoming events at Craig as well. On Thursday, we will host the All City Strings Concert, and we will also participate in a statewide tornado drill the same day. Next week, we will recognize Administrative Professionals Day, where we can take time to thank all the hardworking people in our school's offices, followed by Teacher Appreciation Week starting May 4th. May 2nd is prom, and students are already excited and preparing for the big day. Next Saturday is, of course, Pace for Parkinson's, our school's most well-known fundraiser, and it is highly encouraged that you come out and show support for such a great cause. Thank you for your time, and I'll see you next time.
Next is citizen comments, and first person is Ty Bolarud.
Hi, Ty Bolarud, 419 South Walnut Street. I signed up for Part B Medicare through a Medigap scenario, and Aetna sent me this drug plan. And it says, I don't want you to, their drug plan. So I called up Medicare and canceled it. And then Aetna sent me out the drug list. They said, you're on the plan. And I said, well, I called them up and canceled it. The third time, I told them in no short words, I ain't taking their drug plan. But they sent me a what was equal to a tier three, like narcotics, but tier four, tier five tranquilizers. I'm going down one page after the next page after the next page. And there's hundreds of pharmaceutical tranquilizers on all these pages. And anybody can look them up. It's really, really hard to believe. All opium and caffeine-based, they call Florin, is added to it. And it's like, well, you know, in 2005, anybody can get a lifetime 75% off RX drug plan. We all have a RX drug plan, whether it's sold from Aetna, Anthem, whatever political connection, Republican or Democrat side. But there's some really nasty SOBs in there, such as the Koch brothers that help produce chemicals in there. So I guess, you know, instead of closing our, it was all okay to close our eyes to, I guess, when rock and roll radio stations, 1800 strong, Clear Channel, and they got rid of the rock and roll they didn't want on that rock and roll one radio station, 1800 different satellites. I guess that's all right. We could close our eyes to maybe this RX drug plan and whatnot, but no longer can we close our eyes to the extreme smoke sign up there. It is at schools, and they're roofies. They're Spanish flies. They're date rape drugs. You add it just in a little alcohol, and whoever that person is that other people are looking after, they're drunk and still coherent. And I don't know what school district, how good the liability is on that, but that's no joke. You can actually just take a little drop and put it on your finger. You rub it in, and you go, oh, and you might catch a little tranquilizer effect or whatnot. But if you do it the second time, you let it dry for an hour, and you do it, you can feel it burn into your hand. That's exactly how that stuff works across the board. Our drug plan, I told them when I finally canceled it, they'd have to pay me to take that drug plan. I can get them for free. Who needs a lifetime drug plan? I got a whole set of them. On the back of the card is an 800 number. You can order all sorts of more. Okay, we might want to put it to an option to the people that work here, the colleagues that know the ins and outs as far as union folks, that actually says, hey, that $2,300 the school district is holding on to their health insurance plan, we can give them free and put that $2,300 in their pocket, or most of it in their pocket, and then take and maybe hire somebody to do some research on what kind of stuff that is being promoted in prescription drugs, because not only kids get them, but grandmas get them, grandpas get them. Anybody that goes to the doctor's office, if they get a prescription, they're getting opium. It's opium. It's not, and we don't grow it. We're not making any money on it. It's opium.
Thanks. Next is Ryan Masterson.
Well, hello. I'm Ryan Masterson. I live in 53 Columbus Circle, I guess. I'm a teacher at Craig High School, and I coach basketball at Parker, but I'm here as a parent tonight. First, I want to thank all of you for your service to my kids. I know my dad, and I grew up, was on the city council for many years and spent, I know, a lot of time for really no recognition, and so thank you for that, first of all. But I'm here just to basically with a concern, I guess, with the boundary situation. I have a daughter who's a fourth grader at Adams, and my other daughter is a sixth grader at Edison. She's in the Challenge program, and I guess my concern, and I appreciate all the time the committee obviously has thought of this, a lot of the factors and so forth. But I guess it's been unclear. I guess that I think, at least in the paper, and a lot of the people I talk to. You know, friends. My wife's the PTA president as well, and is that when it takes effect? Mr. Ardrey was kind enough. I emailed him, and he explained it all to me. But as far as that, I think the paper kind of led people to believe it starts with incoming kindergartners next year, And, you know, the fact that it will take effect with, you know, it will affect my fourth grade daughter in a year or so, and it will affect, you know, my sixth grade daughter in a couple of years as well, or could. You know, I think that has not been made as clear as it could have been, and so I have some concerns about that. And I guess the other thing I'm concerned about is, you know, I understand there's some enrollment things, issues driving this, is that I think it'd be helpful. I mean, I guess, you know, the fact that you can school choice still is good, but the fact that it seems unfair to me that my kids who have grown up with the idea that they're going to go to, like my daughter, fourth grader, is going to go to Marshall. We've told her since she's a little kid. Now, you know, she's going to go to Franklin. Now, I went to Franklin. I have no problem with Franklin or anything, but she, you know, it's kind of confusing to her. And, you know, and the fact, too, at kids at Adams, the problem that I have more so is with the high school thing, and obviously I've connections with both schools, so it's not like I'm anti-Parker or anti-Craig or anyway, but the fact that, you know, people who could live on Randall Avenue and go to Adams, same address as Craig, will be attending, you know, at least in the area to go to Parker. It just seems like it's geographically doesn't make sense to me, and so I guess, you know, and that is my concern. So I just feel that it maybe have it just apply to the middle school and not and take the high school out of it, since it's such a far, you know, reach, I think, to have, you know, students that live very, very close to Craig on the same street as Craig to go all the way to Parker to perhaps take that out if the middle school enrollment is the issue, or just leave it alone, I guess, is my suggestion. Because so I just wanted to voice my concerns, but thank you. Mm-hmm.
Next person is Roger Mary.
My name is Roger Mary. I'm at 515 St. Lawrence Avenue in Janesville. I'm here as a private citizen. Don't get caught in the web of unsafe acts. That was a very appropriate way to start during the beginning of this meeting. Last week, you rushed a special meeting in. Sounds like an unsafe act to me. You didn't have any time for public comments. Another unsafe act. You had no input on the legality of the proposals, or some of them that you were making. And then you decided to violate state and federal laws banning discrimination against married people, or because of people's employees' marital status. That's illegal. If that's proven, you're risking losing funding, you're risking paying damages, and you're risking the contracts you make based upon that rush into unsafe acts that you did that. You know, it's a huge step backward, it's a waste of time, and it's gonna be another embarrassment for the school board and for the school district of Janesville. You gotta stop doing that. I'm gonna tell you, your employees keep asking me to sue the school district for them. Think about why they do that. And think about, is that something you're doing wrong, or are you the one that gets to declare the law above the legislature, the Congress? I find what you did last week a violation of your oath of office that you took, a violation of the laws of Wisconsin and the laws of the United States, and as a private citizen, I recommend that you fix that before some judge makes you fix it. We'll see you in court.
Okay, do we have anyone else that would like to comment? Okay, seeing no one else, we will move on. Consider approval of our consent agenda with the additions of the resignations that we have at our spot. We have a motion by Commissioner Schilling.
Second.
Second by Commissioner Hasselbacher. Is there any items that anyone would like to remove for individual discussion? Okay, seeing none, any discussion at all? So, well, I was actually, I mean, is it? Is there any discussion? Okay, no discussion. We will see if the board works. Otherwise, we'll take a roll call vote. The commissioners should vote. And that is approved unanimously.
Is that how you want to vote?
That's what I wanted.
That's what you want. That's what I wanted.
Okay. But it says abstain.
Okay. Our next item is an update on the status of the independent review that was called for. And I just want to give the background of the motion that we passed a little over a month ago. Let's see, did I say that right? Yes, at our February 10th, 2015 meeting, we passed a motion to have an independent representation review the election process with the scope of the review limited to the submission of the nomination papers and how they were reviewed for the ballot. We had some additional motions that did not carry. So after we passed this, then I really was soliciting reviewers. I contacted two retired judges and presented them with our resolution and initially our fax document that we made public actually that night. They had no interest in performing the review. After that, I talked to the Wisconsin Association of School Boards, and they gave me a list of three attorneys initially. And I shouldn't say, they were all attorneys. One was another retired judge and two active attorneys. Talked to the retired judge first. He had no interest in it. And then the next person I spoke with is an attorney with Boardman and Clark. So then we talked through that, really what our resolution was, if he was interested in doing that. He spoke with the partners at Boardman and Clark, said yes. He did not have any previous knowledge of what transpired, so I thought that was as independent as we could get. So with that, Attorney Rooley, if it was James Rooley of Boardman and Clark, as I mentioned. And I would also like to say, I have spoken with him about the review, and he asked how would we like to receive it, myself and another board member. I said, it would be great if you could come share with us. So I have no idea what he's going to say at all. So welcome, Attorney Rooley.
Thank you.
And
thank you. Your summary background is spot on as far as I can recall things, too. I'm kind of reminded of the lyric, fools rush in where wiser men refuse to tread. But I did say yes to this, and a little bit of my background. I haven't been in this school district boardroom for probably 25 years. I'm an attorney in Madison. I have practiced for over 45 years in Madison, and I joined the Boardman and Clark firm in an of-council capacity in January, just a couple of weeks before Greg contacted me. I have reviewed a number of documents in addition to the fact sheet that Greg referred to, the January 26th correspondence from Attorney Moore. I reviewed other material because it was referred to in Attorney Moore's letter, and I wanted to have a sufficient background on the dispute. Coming from Madison, I had not read or heard anything about the difficulties that were being encountered. My review indicates, and by the way, as Greg indicated, Commissioner, to ensure the integrity of the election process, and my review was to be limited to the submission of nomination papers and how they were reviewed for the ballot. As I said, my factual review has included additional material, But I've focused my comments tonight on the election process and the integrity of that process. We won't review the background of the individual disputes that you had. I commend the commissioners whose service is ending today, and I saw Mr. Stefano's name a number of times as they reviewed these things. I think there were a couple of toe stubs on the way. I think there's a couple of things that could have been done differently. But I think the end product of your review, as it was conducted, was very thorough and very accurate. Here are what I would consider, and this is in brief form, arguable errors that may have been made or deficiencies in that process. I offer them for what you think they're worth. And I think you've probably heard these things as you have looked at the decisions from the GAB in the meantime. Obviously, it was probably an error to certify the nomination papers to the county clerk before the period for filing objections had expired. I think that lesson has been established. Obviously, it may have been a similar problem to notify the candidates that there would be a drawing to determine order on the ballot before the period for filing objections had expired. I don't think either of those tainted at all the ultimate process. There was some question about whether the initial objector, you'll recall, Mr. Hughes, whether he was a complainant, and there was a rejection made by your commissioners and your assistant clerk on the basis that he was not a complainant, and the GAB has explained its position that he was not required to fit in that relatively narrow definition of complainant. There were concerns about the fact that one of the candidates used an old nomination form. One of the questions I haven't had answered, or that I don't know the answer to, I should say, is whether that nomination form was presented to her by the district or by the district's assistant clerk. My understanding is that nomination form was taken from a website, and it was not the district's error in providing the nomination paper that did not have the signature blanks. That's the one I'm referring to. I can see some from nodding that you're tracking with what I'm saying here. I think if the district clerk or the assistant clerk had been responsible for that, it would have been a significant shortcoming and one that would not happen again, but one that would be of concern. There was some allegations about inserting information in the header area of the nomination papers after they had been turned in. Certainly best practice that not be permitted. There was also a question about the assistant clerk, a deputy clerk, if that's the word you use here, inserting information in the headers of some of the nomination papers and perhaps not all of them. It would certainly be, I think, a lesson that can be learned from that is that the candidates are responsible for their nomination papers, and they should be filling the headers out. If they have questions about what goes in there, they can talk to the clerk or the assistant clerk to get the answer, but the clerk should not, or does not need to, at least under the law, as I understand it, need to be filling out those header provisions of the nomination papers. And certainly if the district or the clerk or assistant clerk takes the responsibility for filling in information on one form, they should make sure they fill it in on all forms. Of course, the problem with that is some people get the form off the website. So, probably with the greater availability now of websites and those nomination papers coming from other sources, I would think the district would want to reduce the amount of assistance, if you will, that it provides candidates who are taking out nomination papers. Because if you fill in a blank on one, you need to fill in that same blank on all of them. And it's not easy to do that. Um, And of course, the district can confine its role in this process in informing candidates as to where they can get nomination papers, and you can have blank nomination papers available for them. I don't think any of you are surprised by anything that I have said, but I want you to be aware that those errors or deficiencies were discussed in Mr. Moore's letter to you and in the in various decisions of the Government Accountability Board. And I doubt if you need to be fearful that they would be repeated, at least by the personnel who were involved. A couple of suggestions. I think that the district should consider an annual or at least a biannual in-service training session for the people who are going to be responsible. We've learned from this experience that the district clerk has a significant job, lots of responsibilities. This one is not one that he or she would address on a monthly or even a semi-annual basis. It's a one-time annual situation, and the GAB rules have changed. As we learned in this situation, the statute changed to require the blank for the printed name, and it might be appropriate for the district to make sure that the district clerk, in this case, Commissioner Dahmer-Schossen, I wasn't certain how to pronounce it. Okay, Commissioner D, anyhow, and the assistant clerk, who can change from time to time, of course, that they have the opportunity to have the training that's available, whether it's from WASB or the GAB, or I guess the county clerk does some of that too. One of the facts that struck me in this situation is that your assistant clerk was urged by your county clerk to get those certifications in as early as possible. And that may have been part of the reason that there was action taken on January 9th, about 4 or 5 hours before it should have been taken, before the time for objections had passed. I would not fault either the clerk or the assistant district clerk here for that shortcoming. Of course, the district and the commissioner, the district clerk can appoint or designate this role to another individual if he or she wishes. I noted, and this list was made up before I was invited to this meeting, I was going to suggest that you amend policy 8332, and I think you have either done that or are about to do it. I think you maybe did it as part of your consent agenda. And one of the things that of course includes is additional opportunity for in-service and making sure the people who have this job are comfortable that they know what the rules are. Of course, legal counsel can be involved sooner, but the real thing you want to do is have the training, whether it's by a lawyer or by those other entities that we mentioned. And I would imagine a good time to do that is the weeks prior to the January deadlines. We've talked about distributing uniform nomination papers. If you fill in anything, you have to fill it in on all forms. I think the better answer is to have the clerk or the assistant clerk prepared to help the candidates when they ask questions about what goes into the header. You may recall in your situation, it was questioned whether Janesville was sufficient for Janesville School District. That was at least one of the situations. Whether, and in another of your situations, the name of the district was inserted instead of the date of the election. Now you'll recall, and you should be comforted in recalling, that the GAB has looked at both of those situations. The one was a little bit unusually disposed of because there were concerns about the GAB reviewing its own rules and so forth. The other one was handled. I think that was the one that involved Mr. DeSavano. I have carefully reviewed the statutes, including those that Mr. Moore cites in his correspondence and his letter to you, and the GAB rules and the decisions that the GAB issued. And I think it you can find in the GAB decision approval of what this district did. They talk about the fact that the commissioner and the assistant clerk did not abuse their discretion in the way they handled it. There was no claim even in those proceedings that there wasn't that this review by the commissioner and the assistant clerk was inappropriate. The result may have been challenged at some point, but there was no claim that it wasn't appropriate under the law. So I don't have any recommendations to make about you altering that process other than the areas that I have already talked to you about. And when I first spoke with Mr. Ardrey, he made it clear that you were not looking for a critique of what the GAB has done. Those matters were resolved at that time, and the appeals were either still available to the people or at the time had passed. So that's the way I see it. And I don't, if I was in your position, I would not be concerned about the integrity of the process that went on before. I have no indication in what I have seen that there was any impact on the outcome. And of course, you want to avoid the situation where accusations could be made, as they might in a situation like this, that the assistant district clerk helped some candidates, maybe by filling in headers. One another lesson is, of course, that the headers should not be changed, filled in after the nomination papers are submitted. The clerk and the assistant district clerk need to make their judgment on substantial compliance based upon the way those papers are turned in. And that would be another area where you don't want your clerk or your assistant clerk to be perceived as ones who would help out one candidate but not another. And so you eliminate that opportunity. I that's all I really have to say from my notes. I'd be glad to try to answer questions if you have any.
First, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Commissioner Myers.
You said that the county clerk pushed the due date for the submission of the nomination papers. Is that how
Ms. Myers, if I said that, that isn't what I intended to say.
Okay.
What I said is the county clerk, as I understood it, had encouraged all of the clerks in the various municipalities to get their certifications of candidates in as quickly as possible or as soon as possible.
Okay. But
I don't think that the county clerk told them to get it in before the deadlines.
Oh,
but I'm not sure the county clerk visited what those deadlines were. At least in this situation, the assistant clerk seemed to have taken an action several hours before the deadline for objections, and that's what the authorities tell us we shouldn't do.
Okay, thank you for
so if I misspoke, I'm glad I had a chance to clear it up. Is there any other question?
Commissioner DeStefano.
Yeah, while I was not supportive of this review, I appreciate the work you did, and I just wanted to also take this time to also commend our law firm, Nolan Mowat, for the wonderful job that they did and the service that they've provided and will hopefully provide in the future. So thank you, Attorney Moore. I appreciate it.
I am vaguely or barely familiar with those individuals who were involved, Ms. Lewis and Mr. Moore. I do know that they have terrific reputations as lawyers. I actually tried not to let that influence me. But I think your comment is well taken, and I too would express my view, at least, that they handled things very, very professionally and carefully.
Commissioner Myers.
As far as your process was concerned, did you conduct any interviews with any of the people involved and, you know, got their story or anything like that?
No.
No?
No.
Okay. Is that typical?
Well, it was the way I understood the board's authorization to me. I did not understand it to call for an investigation. The one question that I had that I decided not to pursue would have been a question about filling in blanks in those headers, the question really was, did all the candidates get their nomination papers from the district? And I didn't get the answer to that question, and I have shared with you my understanding about why that question is important.
Thank you.
I did not investigate Ms. Myers.
Okay.
I reviewed all of the material as carefully as I could, and that includes a number of documents that Greg initially said he didn't know if that was necessary, but he provided them to me, and I am glad I had the full picture.
Okay. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for your time.
Our next item is consider approval of the boundary line committee recommendation. And for this, actually, I'll go. So before we get started, I number one want to say, well, Tammy Carlson is joining me in this recommendation presentation. The first thing is better to move around. the first thing is absolutely. The work that the committee put in, Commissioner DeStefano, Cheryl Green, Sandy Hazer, Sue Cumlin, Mary Spillman, and then our additions, Steve Hoof and Mike Payne. With not including Steve and Mike only because they applied and was accepted in the committee just back earlier this year. The committee put in many hours. As I go through the timeline, I want to do that to give a understanding of where did the recommendation come from, how long have we really been working at this. As I look back, starting back in February of 2010, the committee met. Introduced and just really talked through what is the boundary line committee. And I one of the things I want to say before that, the committee had not met for a number of years. I don't recall it right now how many it had been, but it had been at least five or more years since the committee had met. And I want to say it was like 2000, but I could be wrong there. So we met, we talked about what we needed to do. What do we review when looking at the boundary lines? Number one, enrollment. Number two, enrollment. Number three, enrollment. And by individual school and see are they acceptable? So as we continued with that, we got into looking at, well, okay, am I, 'cause I'm the chair leading the committee. Well, part of how I look at it isn't just enrollment in my vision, because enrollment is only part of the picture. We need to really look at our facilities to say, what are we capable of from an enrollment standpoint? So we looked at the capacity of our facilities. Then we got into, because once we looked at that, then we noticed there was some differences of enrollment. We talked about potential ways to solve that. And I would say, right then, a pathway model didn't come up from the standpoint of this is what it should look like. It was more of a question is there a model that would be better in handling the progression of students through their education from elementary, middle to high school? Well, as we progressed through that, the then board president, Commissioner Soderman, asked, since the committee was together, would we review the possibility of closing an elementary school, the need to close an elementary school. So basically, 2012, we spent many, many, many hours looking at the possibility, and ultimately we decided not to close any elementary school, which was a great outcome, but we learned lots of things from that. Quite a few things that we have in place today came out of that analysis. Then as we continued, now we were into the spring, and we were still looking at, I would say, the boundary lines and what are our options. So during this period of time, we gave the address of the current students to the city of Janesville. Fortunately, their GIS department helped with this. We mapped out the residences of every student, whether they were in a given elementary boundary area or not, their attendance. So we had all of that data. And from that, we used other information that we learned back when we were reviewing if we should close a school. We found out that, quite frankly, there is no such thing as a neighborhood school in the district from an elementary standpoint, except for maybe one. Arguably, I believe it was Lincoln Elementary was, by the number of attendees living in the Lincoln enrollment area, boundary area, would be actually a neighborhood school. Otherwise, we would have over 42% of the students attended a school outside of their elementary boundary area. And it only gets replicated more as we move into the middle and high school. So from there, we had a working model, and go to the next slide. And with that, with that working model, we spent many times at the particular, the city office working through, is it better to move boundary lines? What do they look like? With the recognizing the capacity of every building, making sure that if we moved a line, we didn't exceed the capacity. So we had to keep those things in mind. We did that probably, I can't remember exactly the months, but it was like over a 3-month period where we were literally, as I said, moving. It was, okay, we'll move a block. What does that look like? So we did much trial and error just to see, did it even make sense to do that? We came up with what was a reasonable change, and I believe that becomes really what the boundary line map that you'll see here shortly. So then we basically, at that point, I would say we sat on the idea, talked about what are the issues, what are the concerns, does it make sense? Well, now back in 13, the enrollment had started to come back up, which we'll look at that in a moment, but it was unclear, are we in a steadily trend up, or have we stabilized from the standpoint of declining enrollment? So we like, well, let's not push to move forward with the pathway model until we feel some level of confidence. So then the next time we reviewed the enrollment data, which we reviewed it in 13, we reviewed it last November, we saw the trend and we said, well, we feel that it is stable. The committee that was present had changed just slightly, so the question came up, is really should we look to add additional committee members? So we really solicited applications, and from that, Steve Hoof and Mike Payne were selected. So then we reviewed really where we were at as a committee and say, okay, here's the background. This is everything we've done. Do we still want to move forward with the pathway plan and model? Yes. So next slide. So then that led to the Boundary Line Committee presenting to the Finance, Buildings and Grounds, and subsequently here at the board just saying this is what's coming up. But one of the things we had to do from the statutes of proceeding through this is solicit community input. Fortunately, Ms. Carlson put together a lot of the materials that we did for our community listening sessions. In retrospect, I would say the one error that we made in setting those up, we didn't vary the times to get more input, but we had an email address, and it was used quite a bit with just questions, and more of the questions comes out is, how does this really affect me as a parent and my students? Very much like Mr. Masterson mentioned earlier, he emailed me several times and to clarify some things. So we went through that, and then we met after our last listening session. What did we learn, and where do we go from here? Well, one of the items that we learned is one very particular, and it was at Edison Middle School, because Edison splits the way the, well, look in the pathway, but the way it splits from an elementary standpoint, some of the students go to Craig, some go to Parker, and one of the parents asked that as we talk continuity of peers, student groups together, would we give a priority if needed from a school choice standpoint if in fact a request came through to keep students together to go to the same high school? So we thought that was a great recommendation, would definitely be one that we included. So then, well, we're here tonight seeking final approval. One of the options, or one of the items that I'll say, and I'll say thank you very much, Mr. Masterson. I've received, as well as other board members, quite a few emails the last several days. And it is clear, and I guess we're sort of the, what comes first, the chicken or the egg? Do we communicate fully without approval, or do we seek approval and then try to communicate? So we decided to seek approval and then try to communicate. So one of the things that, instead of really moving forward with an implementation of, say, starting the beginning of July for incoming students, we will hold off on that, and really we will seek implementation the beginning of next year, 16-17, with the beginning being a potential a transfer period, which is typically December 1st through December 15th, widening that out to go November 1st to December 15th. And why is we really stuck on an ending point of December 15th? Because all of that feeds into the staffing plan. So we open it up on the front end and doing it. So that gives us a lot more time to make sure we can fully communicate and explain by individual student, here's the pathway, and if you don't like that pathway, here are your potential options. So I think that, because it was no way that we know it's a big change in some cases, particularly for a couple of elementary schools. So we wanted to make sure that we can proceed as smoothly as we possibly can and not have, really a negative impact on families from that standpoint. So at this point, I'll turn it over to, I take that back. I won't turn it over yet. Enrollment comparisons. One of the things I wanted to talk about here is, if you can see, and it's a little small from this standpoint, but we see really how the elementary school enrollment has gone. And if you look in the middle and you see the middle school enrollment, it's been fairly consistent with the variation between Edison, Franklin, and Marshall. Marshall has been the steadiest at 900 plus students. And so that becomes really the issue. And why is that the biggest issue? It becomes really the product that we're delivering from the education of all of our students. At Marshall, we would have an issue, still a fine place, great education, But if we look at what the teachers have to do, they simply can't end up being any level of expertise in a given area because they may be teaching math and social studies. Where at some of the other middle schools, simply because the numbers are lower, more balanced, they're able to potentially just teach one subject area in a given team area. So that becomes really our biggest issue. One of the other things that we see is from a high school standpoint, not knowing why, but Parker's enrollment has declined a bit more than Craig has. And we don't know why. I mean, we can see potentially the charter school enrollment and that impact. That wasn't a purview of the Boundary Line Committee to look at the why behind the what we see. That would have to be a different committee to really get into that. So I give that as a background because we see the enrollment from where we were at, and as it progressed lower, and now we've had the steady growth over the last several years within a few students of where we were back in 09-10 school year. So before I go on, is there any questions with any of the background information or the enrollment questions? Commissioner Murray.
Marshall School, do we know how many, and maybe let me clarify, there's open enrolled students that come into the district from outside, from other districts, right?
Yes.
And then if we use this term choice or intra-district transfers, those mean the same things?
Yes.
Okay. So do we know of all the attendance at Marshall currently, how many of those students are inter-district choice? Do we, you know, how many of that population are choice? In other words, they're, you know, instead of going to Edison or Franklin, they have chosen to go to Marshall.
Yes.
I don't actually have that data with me right now. However, I do have that there are 38 open enrollment students at Marshall Middle School amongst the three grades for the 14-15 school year.
So I think the reason that's important to know is because that's a data piece, and the reason I'm asking that is because I visited Marshall, and I truly believe that if we can help with that population size there, that'll help the overall climate for all the academic reasons and safety and such at that school. So the reason I'm looking for that data is if we currently have students that are choosing to go to Marshall, and if it's a significant enough number to help lower that, then we may not need to do this. You know, I'm really curious about that number. I mean, if it's 100, if it's 50, well, we're happy. You know what I mean?
It's about 30 to 40 inter-district.
Thank you.
Year.
Per grade, then?
Total.
Well, okay. Thank you.
Majority are fifth grade coming
in. Right.
Not sure if you heard that, Commissioner Murray. 30 to 40 per year.
For the sake of my discussion, I'll use 40.
Oops.
50. No.
Plus the 38 open enrolled.
Plus the open enrolled. And I'm sorry. This is the data questions you want to ask. So it's, let's say 35. That's between 30 and 40. 35 of our children currently choose to go to Marshall. They're allowed to choose to go to Marshall. And we have about 38 open enrolled students at Marshall. Thank you.
Okay. Any other questions at this point? Okay. Seeing none, we'll proceed on.
So the question comes up, well, what are we actually proposing to change? So here is a picture of our current boundaries as they are at this time. As you can see, there are little kind of cream-colored areas throughout the map here. Those are the elementary option areas. Those areas are areas that do not have a specific elementary school assigned to them. When a student enrolls in the district at the elementary school level, the family requests a school placement through what we call an option placement request process. We have definitive middle and high school boundaries. The middle school boundary, if you follow along Milton Avenue here, and then right along here, along our boundaries in this area right here, is Franklin Middle School's boundaries. Our Marshall Middle School is on the other side of Milton Avenue, down to the river. The river is the boundary on the bottom part, and then over along, this is the Janesville Youth Sports Complex right down here, just to give you an idea of where that's located. So that is Marshall Middle School. Addison Middle School is up along here. It goes up and covers parts of Wilson Elementary School, then follows the river, and then everything down below here is Addison Middle School boundary. Our high schools are split with the large line going along Milton Avenue, Center Avenue, and then County G down to the bottom here. West of that is Parker High School, east of that is Craig High School. So that is what our current boundary is. And as you can see, there are many elementary schools, which are in the colored areas, that do split middle schools and sometimes high schools as well. We have Jefferson Elementary School, Adams Elementary School, Wilson Elementary School, portions of Van Buren Elementary School, and Jackson Elementary School that split either middle school or high school based on their boundary lines. Roosevelt Elementary School in this area right here splits middle schools based on curriculum needs. One-third of their fifth grade class moves on to Addison Middle School with the Challenge Program. And you'll see as we move to the pathway system that was taken into consideration when we made the suggestions for the pathways. So this is what our proposed new map looks like. What we had proposed to do is to eliminate the elementary option areas so that all families, when they purchase a home or rent a home or come into the district, will know exactly what elementary school their particular home assignment is. The area up in this area right in here, the kind of cross area that's yellow, is a Washington Elementary School boundary area. It is a busing area because it is considered a hazardous zone due to lack of sidewalks in that area. And then the area up here, kind of the crosshatch in this area right here, would be a busing zone under this proposal to Monroe Elementary School, which is what it currently is at this time as well. So as you can see with the proposed new map, there are no middle or high school boundaries located in here. What we have done with the proposed pathway system is to take the 12 elementary schools that we have in our district, take our three middle schools, divide that 12 by 3, that equals 4 elementary schools for each of the middle schools. And then because we have 2 high schools, we would divide the 12 elementary schools by 2 for each of the high schools, and 6 elementary schools would be path to 1 high school and 6 to the other high school. So this is our proposed pathway system. This would be starting the 2016-17 school year, as Commissioner Ardrey has already stated. How it works currently with the current proposal is the way that the four are split up would be Harrison, Jefferson, Kennedy, and Monroe would attend Marshall Middle School and then move on to Craig High School. Adams, Madison, Washington, and Wilson would attend Franklin Middle School and then move on to Parker High School. And Addison Middle School would include Jackson, Roosevelt, Lincoln, and Van Buren, with Jackson and Roosevelt pathing on to Craig High School, and Lincoln and Van Buren pathing on to Parker High School. With the pathway system, how it would work is if a family is in a school under school choice by their request, they would adopt the pathway system for the school that their child is attending through the school choice option. So if a family lives in the Madison Elementary School attendance area and they school choice into Jefferson Elementary School for kindergarten, they would stay with their school age peers throughout their whole school career without any need to do any additional request for placement as long as they do not change their home address. That is to keep the peer continuity and to keep the whole school moving together. Now, people may ask, what is that option area? I think I already kind of explained that. That is the physical area within the school district that falls between our defined elementary school boundary areas. That was initially created to help us balance out enrollments at the elementary school level, so we did not go over in one school or another. But because we have moved a large, because we now have the preschool for Janesville program, which means we can better project our kindergarten enrollments because majority of our students are in our P4J program. So we're aware of those students prior to the placement for kindergarten. And we do now have all of our requests for transfers, our kindergarten enrollment, all of that is done prior to our staffing plan. So we aren't needing that option area piece like it used to be utilized. It does also point out here that when basically they need to complete an option placement form, and that students who reside in an option area do not get to reactivate that option area every year or every couple of years. Once they make a school placement assignment, that was their placement. And if they wanted to do a transfer, they would have to do it just like any other student requesting a transfer. So the big question, the ones that you've been getting the emails, I've been getting the emails, everybody's been dealing with, is how does this affect my child personally? We want to limit the impact on our current students as much as possible. So students are not going to be required to change where they are currently assigned for the 15-16 school year. That is going to be they are already scheduled for those schools, they are already staffed for those schools. The 15-16 school year will not be changing at all. We had, during our community listening sessions, talked about opening up the new boundary lines starting July 1st, 2015. So anybody newly enrolling in the district would be covered under those boundaries. After feedback from our families, and Commissioner Ardrey explained that, we are not going to be doing that. We're going to be rolling out the new boundary lines for the 16-17 school year, along with the new pathway system for the 16-17 school year. So everything will take effect for that 16-17 school year. But students who are at a school will be able to be grandfathered into that school regardless of if their address changes under the new enrollment boundaries. So if a student is in third grade right now and their new boundary line, and their, say their school choice into Adams Elementary School, and they have an address that's in the Kennedy attendance area, they are grandfathered into Adams. They do not have to do anything as long as their address does not change. They get to stay at Adams their entire elementary school career. The only instances would be are if they have attendance or discipline issues, which is just like any other family that's under a school choice. Right now, if they have attendance or discipline issues, the district reserves the right to transfer them to their home school. Now, what about those families who maybe want that new attendance area? So we have put in place the process that if they wish to move to their new attendance area school for the 16-17 school year, they're going to request to do so during that time frame, the transfer time frame, that ends December 15th, 2015. This calendar year is when families will ask for that transfer, because we actually start staffing, as you all know, for the upcoming school year. We start that staffing process in January. So this is so that we can get all of those students at the correct school, so that when we get started on the staffing plan, we know where the kids are wanting to go so that we can staff accordingly. That is a way that we can accommodate all of the requests, and so that we can make sure that we utilize our staff to the best ability that we can. Now, as Commissioner Ardrey said, because we anticipate that this time frame may be one that will have more transfers than normal, we will be opening it up from November 1st through December 15th for this time frame to cover all of that and to be able to answer any questions and make sure that we don't have a gotcha kind of situation with our families. So, as I said, the new pathway system will take effect for the transition from elementary to middle school and middle to high school starting the 2016-17 school year. So the grandfathered piece is only for the school that a student is in currently. They are pathed on if the pathway system does, if you do approve this, both pieces of this, the pathway system would take effect for those students at whatever elementary school they're at currently. So they would go on with the pathway at the elementary school that they're at currently. But we wanted to make it very, very, very clear that this proposal does not eliminate the school choice option at any school level. We will continue to have that transfer request time frame that will always be normally in that December 1st through the 15th for the upcoming school year, so future students will have that ability to do that even if they're in, say, second grade right now and their middle school transition isn't going to be for another 4 years. So I did want to point out, kind of just so that you are aware of which areas are most significantly changed by this proposal, there is a small section north of Mineral Point Road that will change from Madison attendance area to Washington attendance area. We have seen that Madison's numbers are continuing to grow. Washington's tend to be a little bit less than they have in the past, so that's a better district utilization of efficiency of those building usages. All Jefferson students will be assigned Marshall Middle School and Craig High School. That was to eliminate that situation where half the school was going to one place and half to the other place. Same thing with Adams. All Adams students would be assigned Franklin Middle School and Parker High School under the current proposal. All Roosevelt students would be assigned Edison Middle School, and their high school would continue to be Craig High School. That's so that all three of the classes at Roosevelt Elementary School would move on to Edison, as opposed to just the one that does currently. And then the Jackson Elementary School busing area, it's west of County G, so that as you're looking at the high school boundary area, it's west of County G, but east of the Rock River. That area right now is a busing area to Parker High School. That would move based on our proposal. That's a Jackson Elementary School attendance area. So the pathway for all of Jackson Elementary School to stay with their peers is currently projected to do Edison Middle School and then Craig High School. So that section there would move from the Parker High School area to Craig High School. It is a busing area, and so the busing changes would happen starting the 16-17 school year. Students would still be allowed that are currently at Parker High School would still be allowed to stay at Parker High School if they wish to do so. However, they starting the 16-17 school year would no longer have access to that district transportation. And then we're going to hand it back to Greg here.
So one might ask, why are we doing this? Well, first and foremost, it was the enrollment situation. I just want to say, we do not expect the enrollment to immediately balance out the 16-17 school year. This is a long-term implementation plan. As we look at where we have been as a board and having many more predictable items, this is one we're trying to go with predictability from a student enrollment and population. That is the number one reason that we're moving in this to this model. And to do so, it really we needed to eliminate the middle school boundaries, the high school boundaries, and have a predictable model being elementary schools. Continuity of student peers. As Tammy talked about, right now we split up friends potentially. I think about one of my son's friends. He went to Adams, and he lived on the wrong side of Milton Avenue. So he went to Parker, and one of his friends went, well, we'll be going to Craig. So as I think about that, it's like, well, we can do a better job of making sure that we don't build in a system to break those up immediately. When we look at the realtors, one of the items that they shared with us is with our option areas and some of those things, it was very difficult to say what school, what a potential house with students attend. Well, we end up with a predictable model all the way through high school. Those are probably some of the bigger ones. I've listed all of the reasoning. And one of the other items here is we look at all of the time spent with adjusting boundaries and looking at what can we do to have the least impact. We will not have any significant transportation costs. I say significant because we will have some costs, simply sharing that there will be a difference, as Tammy mentioned, with the Jackson students previously going to Parker. We'll have to communicate that. The other thing is delaying this until the 16-17 school year. I believe it gives us the opportunity to explain this in great detail to everybody. I mean, this is a lot of details, and how does it affect my child? And that's what everybody really wants to know. And the immediate person would be to go to building principals. Well, they haven't seen this and worked through this in detail. We'll have to have that conversation with them if we approve this. I expect to go to PTA meetings, and furthermore, but as we look at each individual student, we want to make sure that we are providing the information so parents have a clear understanding of exactly the impact it would have to their students and their family. Questions? Mr. DeStefano.
Motion for approval.
Different hat now. I have a motion by Commissioner DeStefano, second by Commissioner Schilling. We're open for discussion. Commissioner Schilling.
When you did this, did you do any sort of analysis what that does to the poverty rates at any of the schools? Because I know that currently we don't qualify for grants at some of the schools based on the poverty rates. So do we know if redrawing these district lines, was there any research done to see if that would adjust any of those schools that currently don't qualify?
I think that would be a potential outcome that we would look into. Once again, the Boundary Lines Committee, our purview wasn't dealing with poverty or anything. It was just balancing enrollment. But that would be one of the items that we would look at as, does this have an impact, and what is that impact?
And at the elementary level, the majority of the changes are just eliminating those option areas, so, and putting them into schools close to their location, so it wouldn't significantly change anything at the elementary level.
Commissioner Myers.
Thank you. You know, as I'm looking at it and thinking about it, if I had a child at Adams Elementary School, I would be really anxious about this. You know, right now, especially as Mr. Masterson said, you know, you got some people that live on the street for Craig High School. You know, and I've heard from other people who bought their house. Ironically, they were told by their realtor that this was their pathway at that time. That's not our fault, but, you know, it's people buy houses with a certain view in mind as to what, you know, what the situation is going to be for their children.
Right, which is why Commissioner Ardrey explained that we don't anticipate that this is going to be an immediate change of our enrollments. Yeah. We anticipate that this is going to be affecting families who are moving into the area that don't have the preconceived notion of the prior boundary lines. Right. We are offering that school choice option. We're continuing to offer that school choice option. This is a long-term kind of view for a change in the future, but we have to start somewhere, and it will not, we're working on it so that it will have the least amount of impact on our families in the district, but still hopefully at some point get to a more equitable enrollment among our schools.
I guess where the anxiety comes from is, and I don't know where this comes from, you know, from these families, is they doubt whether this option, you know, the transfer option or, you know, will be actually granted, since we don't offer guarantees, right? Right. We have kind of a credibility problem, especially for the parents that go to Adam, have their children go to Adam's school. And so I'm just wondering, is there something that we can do to, you know, address this issue, this credibility issue that we have with the parents, especially at Adams Elementary? Is there any sort of priority we could give to the parents that are currently at Adams within the next, you know, couple of years, that their transfers would be accepted? You know, I'm just throwing that out there for discussion. I'd like to know what people think about that, because again, you know, people buy houses based on where they view what their life is going to be like for the next 18 years or so, or 25 years, And, you know, it can be, I like the fact that we pushed it back a year, you know, but it can be incredibly disruptive. And I'd just like to know is there any way that you think that we could, or you think, or anybody else think that we could alleviate some of this anxiety or add perhaps some sort of priority to those parents at Adams School?
Well, we currently have a 20-point priority system for transfer and option placements. There are 20 criteria that we utilize. We don't even look at parent names or student names when we're doing that. Every application is coded by the point system that it falls under, that 1 to 20. And so we can't discriminate against anyone. If we have 30 spots available, we go through and we say this many are number one priority, so they get in first, and then up to the filling up the spots. That's definitely something that could be looked at. Principal Taylor at the Marshall Middle School listening session made it very clear to everyone that the middle schools were going to be honoring the transfer requests that come in during a timely manner. We've opened up the transfer time frame for a longer time period this first time so that we can get that communication piece out. We are looking to individually give every single student in the district a letter that explains, here is the home address that we have for you, here is the pathway system that you would, here are the schools that are covered under that location, here is the school that you are currently attending, and here is what would be the pathway system based on that. All of those letters would be going out before that November 1st time frame so that we can make sure that we communicate with every single student in this district so that they can be aware of how this would impact them and have the ability and the time frame to be able to ask for that transfer and not miss that deadline.
So maybe an easier way of saying, the only way I think we can truly alleviate the anxiety is communication. Will that completely alleviate it? Probably not, but that's one of the reasons why we are came up with the plan that we have, is to fully communicate. So,
I have another question that popped in my head while you were talking, based on something you said. And
sorry.
I left the building.
So. I'm sorry. I'll let other people talk amongst yourselves for a bit while I sit here.
Commissioner Hesselbacher.
I have a question just about the high school. Kind of thinking long term. What is the capacity of our two high schools, of Parker and Craig? Like, are they built for 2,000 students, 2,500 students? What's the maximum that Craig could comfortably serve?
When we say up.
I'm not sure who I'm addressing this to. So
that's a complicated question. It comes down to room usage.
Okay.
I can tell you that we have served more than we have now in the past, probably about 200 more than I'm serving right now.
Okay.
But that would mean I'm probably in the upper 90 percentage in terms of room usage, mm-hmm. which makes scheduling difficult.
Yes, I remember the presentation from Mike about a long time ago about that very thing. Okay.
Want to say, as we look at, and one of the things that I did as we reviewed elementary schools is I did a walk through all the schools. So when we looked at building usage, room usage by every building, how we actually use the building really gets to the point of what is the true capacity. So in most cases, the capacity is significantly higher, but we have to change some of the programming that we do and manage that differently. So, and part of the picture as I say that, and I think of Adams in particular, they have nooks and crannies all over that particular building with its many additions. Well, they use all of those nooks and crannies as places to do individual student to, I'll say, adult learning. Though we'd have to explore many more of those things as enrollment increases in any individual building.
But for the foreseeable future, it doesn't sound like either Parker or Craig is crammed full and could not possibly accept students from one side of that line or the other who want to go to the other school. Is that fair to say that for the foreseeable future they could go to either school based on, for whatever reason, they'd want to go to either school? Okay, thank you.
Well, and the current the current lines, that the way they are drawn, if people are school choicing, some of the students are being moved. So if people are school choicing, it's just kind of bringing back in kids that are already there anyway. So that kind of is to keep in that in mind as you're looking at that. Okay. Are we going to move major numbers? Thank you.
Okay. Commissioner Sodom.
Let's talk busing again. So you mentioned the Jackson area. Mm-hmm. So the students who are grandfathered in, if they choose to now, let's say, go to Parker because they're closer, because they're in that area you talked about, mm-hmm. they can't get a bus fare there? I mean, they can't get transported there, or can they?
Through the district, there would be no transportation starting the 16-17 school year. The bus that would normally go by their home would now go to Craig High School as opposed to Parker High School.
Even if they're grandfathered in. So grandfathering doesn't cover transportation. Only
grandfathering does not cover district-provided transportation. It would only cover you being allowed to stay at that school, but you would be required to find your own transportation if you wish, or you're welcome to utilize the district transportation to the new school.
Is that the only district that this, I mean, so the only
area
that
yes, that is the only area we made sure when we created the areas, we looked at the current bus routes, and the elementary bus routes did not change at all. The middle school bus routes did not change at all because the busing areas are on our outlying parts of the district. So Madison and Washington are busing area. Van Buren, Jackson are the busing area, and then Monroe Elementary School and the Eastern Quadrant are busing areas. That's why we did not change that busing area north of Highway 14 to a different school. We had that continue at Monroe, so it would limit the impact of the changes in busing. But by going to the pathway system, Jackson Elementary School was the one busing area that split between the two high schools. So it's middle school does not change, that busing area for middle school does not change, but it was the one elementary area where either way we put them, they would have a portion of their students being bused to a different location.
And 2 miles is the distance that is the key?
The 2 mile busing is only at the elementary school level or outside of the district boundaries. Anything at the middle and high school level, we have a city plan, which means that because we have city bus transportation, anything within city limits at the middle and high school level can be farther than 2 miles, and the district is not required to provide transportation.
So currently Adams, Milton Avenue kind of separates the district. So if those who live on the east side of that and now are in the Parker area, that's still within 2 miles, and so begin, but because high school doesn't make a difference.
Middle and high school does not make a difference. We currently have middle and high school students in the upper quadrants of the Jefferson attendance area that go to Franklin Middle School and Parker High School that are more than 2 miles, but because it's within city limits and at the middle and high school level, no transportation is required to be provided by the district.
And we accept transfers within the district as long as there's room.
Right, and our physical capacity, as everyone has explained, is able to accommodate the request that we have right now. We asked for that during that December 1st through the 15th transfer timeframe so that we can have our staff be appropriately assigned based on where they're asking for school.
So it's based upon physical capacity, not for instance, let's say we have 3 third grades, what's ratio, 30 per student at third grade?
The maximum at third grade is 25 students in
25.
A classroom.
So we have school X has 3 third grades, all at 25 students. And I want to open room my student into that third grade at that school. There's plenty of physical room, but now we're going over our board guidelines. Do you still accept them? Now break up into 4 third grades? Or do you say, sorry, this physical room, but you know what? We're not going to add a teacher just for your student. We can't accept you. Is there also personnel limitation, just physical?
It is a personnel situation as well as physical space. However, the majority of our open enrollment, you're giving an open enrollment example, which is coming from outside the Janesville School District into our district.
So I'm not talking within. So I'm.
You meant school choice?
Yeah, within
okay.
the district.
The majority of our transfer requests or school choice types of requests, actually those come in at the incoming kindergarten level prior to us even creating a staffing plan. So we do review those based on who's requesting, and all of those numbers get put together on this many kids live in this attendance area, this many kids are asking to come into the attendance area, this many kids are asking to leave the attendance area, this many kids have siblings but haven't asked to come in here, so are we guessing if they're going to come or not? So we have a very big model that happens while we're reviewing those transfer requests in December, and from that model, that's how we develop how many classroom sections we have after we've put everyone in their place.
So I move into town. I just came in now.
Yep.
My third grade, I'll have a son for a change, okay? And because I work over here, although my home school is Y, I want them to go to X because that's easier for me.
If,
but X has a situation where they have 3 third grades at the Gills. Am I then told no?
Correct.
Okay.
We would deny that request. And what we do, we have what's called a hotspot status, which means that we keep spots available for any families that would be moving into that attendance area at the different grade levels. The hotspot status is 2 students per classroom. We hold spots for any students who may move into that attendance area. Now, there are circumstances where we may go over that hotspot because of a special ed placement that needs to be at a school, or a sibling. We try not to split up sibling, obviously, for
reasons. If we're within a hotspot number, you'd probably tell me no.
If we are at the maximum 75 and it would require us to go over the limit, you're correct. We deny that. But if you have some wiggle room within those hotspot statuses, that's for those types of situations where a family would be moving into the district, or we have a situation with a sibling or a special ed placement.
The neighborhoods go through changes. They recycle. They might go from young kids to older and back to young again, depending upon, you know, just development. So I'm assuming we'll revisit the grade school boundaries every census period, every
generation.
Is there a time frame? Obviously, just like you mentioned, moving as a Madison and Washington school boundaries a little bit because of the size.
Mm-hmm.
That'll be done as a regular basis that your committee will continue to meet every other week?
Yeah. Okay. We will, once the enrollment is shared, then the boundary line committee chair will call a meeting and review the enrollment to just understand, has there been any movement? And it may be a, nope, we're still good and off we go. But if we start to see a shift, then we will have to address that.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, other questions? Commissioner Dahmershausen.
Yeah, I have some questions. You had alluded to the fact that there was a transition period over like X number of years to actually get to the point where we wanted to be. I remember at one of the listening sessions, you had said it won't happen overnight. It'll take a period of years to get there, probably 12, 13 years before you really arrive. Is that correct?
Correct.
Okay. So, that being said, Mr. Masterson brought up a thing. He bought a home. You're saying he's safe through Adams, but after that, all bets are off. Couldn't we grandfather people now, without breaking the law, because it's our law, we're creating our rules, to allow them to follow the present path that they bought a home for? Not everyone's going to follow it, but there are certain ones that did buy and expect to follow it. And if I were a parent, I'd be very anxious that I've got to change my life, my work, everything around that, because this is what a new thing is, and we had an expectation. And that expectation has consequences if you change it. So are we able to help these people all the way through the path until our schools have kind of filtered out everything that's needed? Because some of the parents will like the new path. It'll fit into there. Some won't, especially the newer ones that are moving in. So what can we do to help people?
So are you done? Just are you done?
For now I am.
Okay.
Thank you.
So part of having the school choice as an option. And recognizing that someone moving in new, then they wouldn't have any preconceived ideas with respect to a path. So if they follow, then we would see the enrollment start to equalize out, allows room for the choice. So really that's the equalizer, is the choice program, recognizing that the parents with students currently enrolled will may more than likely enjoy their students going to the potential boundaries that we had. We didn't actually have a pathway, it was boundaries. But once we eliminate the boundaries, then we have to have some way of guiding that. So that would really speak to more of the choice program or the choice options with the series of options to work through that.
You've answered part of it.
Okay.
But I still haven't gotten an answer. And I'll pick on poor Mr. Masterson out there in that. Can you guarantee that he will continue on the present path he bought a home for and expected his children to follow? Greg, you
yeah,
bought
right.
a home.
No, I can answer that.
And you bought a home, and your expectation is something for your son and your daughter earlier. And you always related that it was nice that they could stay with their friends and move through. That's good. But this is some of the things that they have to make a decision. They could have the thing say, well, our friends are going over there. We might want to go there. But they may want to say, I really want to stay where we planned, because now I've got to change who picks it up, daycare, various things that I wasn't expecting to do.
Sure.
So what can we do? The question is, can we give them some kind of a guarantee, at the very least a priority of being able to do that? And we're not asking forever on other people, just the ones that are currently have children enrolled in that school.
So when we talk the series of to make the choice, the 20-point list, everything that you mentioned falls into the list of whether it's a sibling, whether it's programming, whatever the case may be. It could be daycare needs, transportation needs. All of that is captured within the point system when it comes to that school choice piece. You mentioned me specifically, so I will also address me specifically. I lived in an option area, and I had the option between Harrison, Monroe, and Roosevelt. We chose Monroe, and that's where my daughter went. And then when it was time that we wanted to buy a house, we looked for a house not thinking middle school or high school, but to keep her at Monroe. That was what we were thinking. We did find a place to build a house that was in that area, and then shortly thereafter, the district made the decision to build Marshall right next to Monroe. Well, that worked out great, but as I said, it was strictly the Monroe area. We didn't actually give any thought to Marshall or Craig at all from that standpoint. So in Mr. Masterson's case, when he looks at, we wouldn't say that his daughter couldn't go to Craig. It just would, from a choice standpoint, would go through those options. And one of the things that's clear that we recognize that there is a transition period, but to say we can guarantee that, we can't guarantee that. As we look at, based on staff enrollment, based on TPRs, and all of those things all come into play. So to say it's a guarantee, we wouldn't be able to guarantee it. But by and large, most of the requests are filled today. The majority.
Yeah.
I mean, the vast majority, as they request a choice, it falls out, and that's what we have. We have capacity in our middle schools and high schools. So I would not anticipate that being an issue, because some will flow out of Marshall. But do we have capacity at Marshall? We do have capacity at Marshall. So
I'll say thank you. I just want to make sure that there is some weight, strong weight, given to current positions towards for these families and their children.
Sure.
So thank you.
Okay. Welcome. Commissioner Murray.
Just make sure I'm correct. At one of the meetings, I brought up the, and I made a comment at, well, what about these open enrolled students that are at Marshall? Mm-hmm. Why don't we just say they can't be there anymore? Mm-hmm. But you told me there's a state statute that guides that.
Correct. There is a state statute that requires you to treat open enrollment students. Once they've open enrolled into your district, they are required to be treated exactly like all resident students as far as all of your policies and procedures are concerned. The state of Wisconsin does allow school districts to require reapplication between either elementary and middle school or middle and high school. The school district of Janesville does currently have in policy the requirement to reapply for open enrollment between elementary and middle school. However, due to our board goals of wanting to increase enrollment, we have approved all open enrollment requests to their requested middle school, because when we had denied open enrollment requests for middle school in the past, it actually greatly reduced our open enrollment numbers because families weren't willing to just hope that they would be able to stay with the students that they had been in elementary school with their entire career, and then find out at the middle school transition that, no, I'm sorry, you can't go there. You have to go to a completely different school with students that you're not familiar with. So we do have that reapplication option. It is during the open enrollment time frame, which is in February through May. However, we do contact all of our open enrollment families and ask them which middle school they want to attend, and they'll be asking for, so that when our middle school principals create their staffing, they are including those open enrollment students when projecting for staffing.
Can you go back to this,
sure,
the one slide about the most significant changes?
Mm-hmm.
That one. All right, so I agree that the communication piece is going to be so pivotal, and from what I've learned through all these sessions is that we are well prepared for no change because of choice, and because we want to honor choice just like it is today. So that was really very on my mind. I needed to hear that over and over again. But what I'm saying is, I'm overgeneralizing, however, is that if I'm a parent and I really want or expected my son and or daughter to go to any of the middle schools, but I'll use Marshall, that the sooner I can get accepted through choice to that tract, I'm in. Is that correct? So I could say I go to Adams.
Mm-hmm.
Currently I'm in Adams, and I say, boy, I really want to go to Marshall Craig. I can stay at Adams and choose in the winter, you know, the December of each year, no later probably than my sixth grade year in December. I should at least do that by then.
Fifth grade year. If you would like to go to Marshall,
I'm yep. Sorry.
K-5 is elementary.
I'm still in
you're back in when
high.
I went to school.
right. I mean, because then you really need to know that if you want to go to Marshall, you better really be cognizant of that.
Well, and our current procedure, just so that you're aware, our current fifth graders and eighth graders are all provided a letter are given to those students with, this is your home address, this is the middle school that we have you assigned to. If there are any changes, please contact your guidance counselor at your current school. If you would like to do a school choice, here's the December 1st to the 15th time frame. Those letters are provided to the students either at the fall conferences, at the middle school level, they usually provide those at fall conferences. At the elementary level, those are given out to students in the month of November. So the current policy is to let students know what middle school they are at already. So this proposal that we're doing for next school year for the communication piece is just a way that we're now providing everyone in the district so that they have the knowledge in advance, much greater in advance, like you said, with that communication piece.
Just to make sure though, once I've gone through the choice selection process and my application is accepted,
mm-hmm,
I no longer have to go through that again. I'm in my path.
You're in your path as long as your address does not change.
Okay, thank you.
Commissioner Myers?
So I hate to belabor this point. So you would not have to reapply to go to Craig then. You're
Correct.
Automatically. So if you go to Adams and you say, I'd like to be, are we talking about people from outside the district in that case?
Okay, no. Adams with the new proposal would do Franklin and Franklin and Parker.
Okay.
So if you are school choiced into Adams, if you approve this policy tonight, the Adams students would not need to do any additional paperwork as long as they don't move to be able to go to Franklin and Parker.
I guess
if they wish to go elsewhere, then the year before they would want to go elsewhere, they would need to apply during that December time frame.
So I guess I would like to, so let's say I currently have kids that go to Adams and I want to send them to Marshall, and mm-hmm. I do the inter-district transfer to Marshall. And then am I guaranteed to go to Craig?
They are guaranteed to go to Craig because all of Marshall goes to Craig High School. All of Franklin goes to Parker High School.
Okay.
At the Edison Middle School level, it is a little bit more complicated because they do split half and half. So at the Edison Middle School, it would be based on where you attended elementary school.
Thank you. And one more question. So, so there's limited capacity at, let's say, Marshall. And I am a parent that wants my kid go to Marshall, and I am from outside the district, and I want my kid to go to Marshall, okay? So
okay.
Both kids, the one coming out of Adams and the one coming from outside the district, are trying to get into Marshall at the same time. Is there any priority given to someone transfers within the district than to someone that comes from outside?
That's an excellent question. Traditionally, our open enrollment students start at the elementary school level in our district. We have very few students who open enroll at the middle school level.
Okay.
It's usually students coming in at the kindergarten level or students coming from a parochial school setting into our high school level. So that question that you have regarding a brand new open enrollment to our middle school and then a regular student requesting a transfer is very rare. However, it does happen. And the way that that gets the priority is because we have our December 1st through the 15th transfer time frame is for those students who are currently in the district.
Okay.
That's prior to our staffing. Any new open enrollment requests, the open enrollment period goes through April 30th. So we're not even required by law to review those new students to the district through open enrollment until after that April 30th deadline. So our staffing plan has already been created. So our open enrollment students that are requesting in, they get filtered into where we have space in the district based on our staffing TPRs. So they do, the students who are in district do get that priority because they get to apply before we create the staffing plan. Brand new open enrollment students to our district have to apply after the staffing plan's already been created and get placed into wherever we have space.
Okay. I guess that makes me feel a little bit better about this because it seems to be that, you know, elementary to middle school transition that is the real concern. And you know, the majority of the people that I've heard from are in Adams, and you know, I have a feeling that that there will be some, because you know, you mentioned Commissioner Dahmer's house, you mentioned the economic impact, right? There was one parent in particular that said, you know, this our work situation makes it difficult for us to go all the way across town. So I'm assuming that those people would be able to
would
school choice pretty easily, or you know, I mean, I get the fact that there's not 100% guarantee, but I do think that, you know, that's one of the priorities on the list. I have a feeling that a lot of people are going to find that even though they're not happy about moving all the way from Adams to Franklin, their kids are going to want to stay with their peer group.
Correct.
More than anything, and you know, the parents are going to have to make a decision about whether they want to keep that, you know, and whether that's a priority. But I guess, you know, I'm still concerned about the Adams situation. I feel better about the opportunity for them to open enroll or to change school, choice school, and then continue the path that way. So I have some reservations still about those people from Adams, but I think I'm going to vote for this.
And I would like Commissioner Myers, the reservations that you have,
yes.
We as a committee had those same reservations. And that's why it took the time to go through to say, can we organize this in a manner that has the least impact? And this is the least impact that we had. And recognizing the choice piece, I know it isn't comfortable because there is no guarantee, but based on the history that we've had, we as a committee felt comfortable moving forward that the majority, if not all of those requests, could be honored. So that was, but yes, we, and I would look at every person on the committee and we still would yell, yeah, okay, this will be interesting, just as with that reservation in mind. Commissioner DeStefano.
I was just going to say, I think we've labored this enough. I call the question. Let's vote.
That is another vote. I think we're probably done anyway. But anyway, there is no debate for that one.
That's right. We need two-thirds approval.
Yep. So is there a, nope, no seconds needed. excuse me. So we have the question that's been called, and the board should vote on that now. I wanted the options here. And that passes on 8-1. The lone no vote is Commissioner Ardrey. All other commissioners voted yes. So with that, we have a motion to, and a second, to eliminate the middle and high school boundaries and reestablish the elementary boundaries as presented, as well as establish the pathway plan. Anyone understand? Okay, the board should vote. And that passes unanimously. Before we move on, I would just like to say publicly, thank you very much, Tammy. She has been an absolute godsend on our committee. That's why she's the one answering a bulk of the questions here, because of the great work she's done. So thank you very much.
Thank you.
Next on the agenda, update on the fiscal 2015 operating budget preparation process. Mr. Pennington.
Good evening, everybody. It's nice to be back in my end of meeting spot. I feel a lot more comfortable here. Good evening, everybody that stayed this long. I usually don't have anyone to talk to, so thank you. I appreciate it. We're going to have another update on our budget discussion. Again, I was just up here, 6 days ago, so there's not a lot of changes. And I won't go over a lot of the detail that I did spend again as the reminder of why we're doing this, what our goal is, and so on. I just want to jump straight to the current proposed budget changes where we left them last week. We have a net shortfall of about $1.9 million still. Now, again, trying to say it in a different word or a different way, trying to find all kinds of directions. What that means is that we have to come up with $1.9 million before we have any wage increases, before we add any staff for the 5-year, before we add money for the professional performance structure, or some of the various other items we've talked about before. We need $1.9 million before those items. If we add those other items, we have to find the money for that. And again, our key questions is, where is the money going to come from? What needs to be cut to balance the budget? Now, in a couple minutes, Dr. Schulte will present some detailed dates regarding our budget presentation. But in the meantime, last week sometime, I can't recall who asked the question or where it was raised, but somebody said, well, could we refinance our debt to help close our shortfall? And what I want to remind everybody is that our debt is part of Fund 38 and 39, our $10 million of bonds. Bonds can only be refinanced if a portion of the bonds are callable. And right now we don't have any of those, but even if we did, the Fund 38 and 39, if we did refinance, as we have in the past when it's available, That does not create money for us to put into Fund 10. Those are debts and bonds that were issued. So what any sort of refinancing would do would just lower potentially the amount of property tax that the taxpayers would have to pay. So if our, let's just say a simple example, if we had $3 million worth of bonds that we financed and we saved $50,000 a year against, again, these are nonsense numbers, the $50,000 a year would not go against Fund 10, it would just drop the tax levy by $50,000. So I just wanted to throw that out there as a reminder that while we do have some options, anything that has to do with our Fund 38 or 39 is not an option. And again, Dr. Schulte will talk about some of the items we have coming up in the calendar and in the schedule to discuss, and which will be presented within the next few weeks.
Commissioner Soderman?
Go back a slide, Keith. We don't know for sure, but our consultants from Associated took a good guess stab at what the spousal surcharge would save.
Mm-hmm.
That's about $400,000. So how do we, I mean, we don't know because we're in new territory, so you didn't include it in here. But at some point, I mean, it is going to save us something. We don't know what, but it's
right.
$400,000 is the best guess for now.
The reason that's not on there tonight was I actually didn't get, I got an updated schedule right before the meeting.
Okay.
Where using two models, it was between something like $150,000 and $300,000. I didn't put it on there because I hadn't had a chance to look at it. And again, $300,000, if it's that's the most, it's a big number, but it wasn't going to materially affect our surplus number for the point of presentation tonight.
Okay.
And as I've said before, you know, I did misspeak last time where I said I've been presenting this presentation every meeting since January. I actually started in December. So you've been listening to me every time for 4 months.
Going every minute of it.
Not
so,
3 months.
All right.
But all of these, as we've said along, some of these, now the loss of categorical aid, that's a mathematical formula. The enrollment-driven staffing plan was a mathematical formula using an estimate of the average teacher wage. So the health insurance adjustments, the dental coverage, that's an estimate right now. What's going to happen is as we progress in the budget process, we create a gigantic spreadsheet that lists every single name, every single person, and the numbers that were given to us from the insurance people were based on the fact if the enrollment and the exact breakdown for next year was exactly the same it was this year. So that's where those numbers are coming from. When we get our budget numbers, as we progress with that, we'll have more accurate numbers. Odds are it's not going to be materially different, but at this point, this is the best estimate we can come up with, and it should be fairly close. These will change. There will be some weeks where we won't talk about, or nothing technically will happen from one presentation to the next presentation, but I might have a changed number because a estimate may be tighter or new information may have come about to make it more accurate.
So will those estimate savings be in the next time you give us this slide?
Yes.
Okay.
Commissioner Thompson.
At what point are we going to start showing revenue from the several different foreign student programs we've got going? Where you handed out those spreadsheets and staffing, and I don't see any of those revenues up there at all. You follow where I'm coming from?
Yeah, that budget has not yet been presented or approved by the board. So these are things that have gone through the board. And once things are finalized or we get information from the state or whatever, that's when it comes up to. I haven't put any projected numbers up there yet if the board hasn't approved it. Because in the past, that would have been considered presumptuous.
Right. No, I don't know if we're going to go back over those sheets which you distributed, which we just covered very briefly, you know, and just agreed to two staffing. And I don't know if that's coming back to the board, but if I understood those figures, that's potentially a $300,000 plus revenue after expenses. I mean, it was like $2 million additional expense, but then mm-hmm. two, three So that's why we're wondering that potentially $300,000 plus. Okay, thank you.
Commissioner DeStefano.
Yeah, just to add on to Commissioner Soderman, as far as the spousal surcharge, after the open enrollment is done in May, they'll have a very good estimate on what the spousal surcharge numbers will be. But that, again, will be, it will change a little bit as staff leaves or comes on. But I would say you'll be very close at the end of May as far as what you'll be.
Yeah, and I think I did a backwards calculation just for my own sake to get an estimate, and doing it backwards from the savings, if the only savings comes from people paying $150 a month, it translated into about 80 employees selecting to do that. That was their projection. But I didn't feel comfortable enough putting that up there yet, since I got it at the last minute.
Other questions? Okay, seeing none, thank you.
Mm-hmm.
I'm all. Oh, no. You threw me off here. Announcements. Commissioner DeStefano.
Well, since this we didn't have a What's Right in Education, I wanted to recognize Mr. Furman from Marshall Middle School. I had to laugh the other day when we got our report cards, and I'm looking at my daughter's report card, and under math, and she has Mr. Furman, there was a paragraph, basically about a paragraph and a half, of individualized comments on the report card. Not pleasure to have in class, that sort of stuff, but individualized comments. I immediately had a smile on my face and thought of Commissioner Schilling. Yeah. But when I asked other people about this, it wasn't just my kid, and it wasn't just Deb's kid. It was everyone's kid.
Did it for my kid.
Absolutely. And he's done from even before Commissioner Schilling brought this up. And we have a lot of outstanding teachers, you know, but I want to, you know, recognize that, because I think that's going above and beyond. I know that takes extra time. So just wanted to recognize Mr. Furman on a job exceptionally well done.
Thank you. The school district has been very fortunate to have Principal Edlefson in our district. And just want to recognize her for being an assistant principal at Edison Middle School and also as principal at Roosevelt. And I think the students at Roosevelt and at Edison and the parents at both those schools and our staff at both those schools have seen the strong leadership that Deanne has provided. And we want to wish Deanne Edlefson the best in whatever she selects to do as she moves forward in her career. Thank you.
Dr. Schulte.
Thank you. This Saturday, Craig High School track and field team holds Earth Day and Tornado Awareness Event. Our teacher, Mike Price, who I don't know if you guys remember him, who's on the roof last year raising money for Bags of Hope. He's just a real go-getter. And he's spearheading this again. So Saturday, April 11th, 8 to 1, they'll kick off Earth Day with the team. We'll be there collecting electronics and appliance recycling to prevent these items from ending up in the landfills. Everything from computers, computer equipment, appliances, DVD players to cell phones and chargers, laptops, and tablets will be accepted for no cost. TVs under 32 inches. And computer monitors, and there's some fees then that they'll get for those as part of their fundraising. And then along with that, if that's not enough, as part of Tornado Awareness Week and in light of the recent tornado in the Rockford area, the track team will also be collecting donations during the recycling drive to help with the relief efforts and those affected by the tornado. And at the end of the event on Saturday, the donations will be delivered down to one of the local collection sites.
Dr. Earhart.
You heard it once tonight, but just a reminder that on Thursday at 7 p.m., Craig High School is the all-city strings concert.
Dr. Cargo.
Thank you. Tuesday, April 21st, at Edison Middle School, there will be a Janesville Town Hall meeting that will focus on prevention, law enforcement, the judicial system, treatment, and recovery all around heroin. And so this event will begin at 5:30 with the resource fair, and there will be a panel discussion between 6 and 7:30 that night. And then after that, from 7:30 to 8, the resource fair will continue. But there are five different people that will present on that panel presentation. Janesville Mobilizing for Change, Police Chief David Moore, District Attorney Dave O'Leary, AODA Specialist Amanda Lake, and Your Choice to Live Incorporated. And so we are really promoting this event as a community. We want to make sure that we reduce heroin use within the Janesville community. So again, Tuesday, April 21st, from 5:30 to 8 o'clock. The panel presentation will be 6 to 7:30. Thank you. At Edison.
Commissioner Dahmershausen.
Hi, thank you. I want to bring up that next week on the 23rd in Lake Geneva, there's kind of a board enrichment thing with the Wisconsin Association of School Boards, and they hold it every spring. It's meant for new members to the board and others, in which is kind of a what to expect, what should you be doing. All people can learn from it, and the experienced people can contribute thoughts and experiences they've had. I will be going. I'll set something up, maybe leave from St. John Vianney's parking lot if they aren't occupied that night. And anyone that wants to ride with me that's a board member or the new board members, they're welcome to go with me. I'd be leaving about 5:45. It starts at 7, lasts about 2 hours. I can only take so many, but if I really crowd them, I can get most of the board in there. But you can't sit on my lap. That's it. That goes too far. But my car does hold at the most 6 people besides myself. There'll be a little crowd in the back, so the third seat. But anyway, anyone's welcome to ride with me in that, and I would welcome it. It costs you nothing, but they would like you to pre-register. Deb can help do that. It's no fee. You do get points for it, and that towards enrichment and that of your thing. You don't have to enroll, have to register to go, though, and that. But they would like that so they know what to expect and what size room over at the high school there. So I've been there, and I'm glad to take anyone. Sure. Thank you.
Okay. Other announcements? This was mentioned earlier, but we actually had an invitation to all board members that we're invited to the class of 2016 junior prom, a crystal ball. This coming Saturday at the Armory, Parker High School, 8 p.m. to midnight. The Grand March and Coronation will be at 10 p.m.
Yeah, just what the students want to see. Let's all wear our prom dresses.
For I've gone to them. They love it.
I simply did really what was asked. Okay. Other announcements? Seeing none. Future board agenda items. Commissioner Shelley.
I have a list.
Yeah. Did you put it in writing?
The one thing I ask is that as a board, you guys explore the option of being able to let people join meetings via telepresence and what it would take to do that, because I think that with the current configuration of how we run things, we very much limit the people who are able to serve on the board. That is being one of the main reasons why I was unable to consider to continue, is because of my travel schedules would not allow me to be physically at board meetings and to have a seat at the board and not be able to vote is unfair to the community. So I think that I would like the board to truly revisit that and create a policy as to how that would happen so that you can actually have a more diverse group of board members running for election.
Sure. So that's on our list of policies to review. So other future board agenda. Dr. Schulte.
I have a couple, so I'll go fast. First of all, Commissioner Thompson requested information about our budget in regard to the other 20%. So we know 80% is for salary and benefits, basically. And so information about the 20%. So we explored perhaps doing a board workshop But let me go through our timeline of some other things, and then you can tell me where this would best fit for all of you or for those of you that are interested. So the Finance Committee will be getting busier. On April 21st, the capital improvement budget will come forward to the finance meeting, so that's next week already. That will come through as it does every year. Keith, with Dave Leader, will let you know what's on the list, what has to be repaired, so what's a must-have, and what can wait, and so you'll get a good idea of the amount that is being looked at for capital improvements. Then that will go to the board on April 28th. Then May 19th at the finance meeting will be the technology budget, and by Dr. Smiley, and he will outline his needs and the costs in regard to that and what he believes are must-haves, needs, wants, wishes, all of those things. And then that will come to the board May 26th. So those are slices or pieces of that 20%. Those are two rather big pieces of information that you'll want to hear about either at the finance meeting or then at the board meeting. And again, it continues to put the puzzle pieces together of the overall budget. And then if you saw the Gazette this morning, it looks like the state aid will not be voted on until towards the end of May. And of course, that's another big piece that we're all waiting for to hear. And typically we receive estimates on our revenue caps on July 1st. So then, again, that will give us an initial estimate of our 15-16 budget. So that gives you a sense of the timeline of where we're going with this. Employees, certified employees will get their contracts on Friday. Or not?
Yes.
Okay, so I intend to put the timeline in a letter too, so employees will know again what the timeline is for the budget. It's been the same for at least the last 2 years, this timeline that we follow. I know everyone is always anxious to hear about, are there any raises this year, but by my estimation, it's way too early to be able to decide because we don't have all the information yet. And as has happened every year, there will be changes. Am I correct, Mr. Pennington, to the budget? It is not locked in. You'll see many changes before July, August comes. So given that information, are there board members that are interested in a budget workshop, budget 101, on that 20%, which we could do before a board meeting, and certainly invite new board members too? Or do you feel like you'll get enough of that information in the actual committee meetings or coming to the board? No, I'm just kidding.
Mr. Thomas,
we do have another option, because I think that's an excellent idea. But WASBA also would bring one of their people down. We could have a meeting that allows them to go through not only the changes and that, but what is the difference of parts of a budget and that. And they could probably do it within a couple hour period, and we could ask questions. It changes. It's a moving target, and I think your idea is good.
And of course, that's up to the board.
Whatever you want to do. The slice that Keith will give you will be the school district of Janesville budget. So obviously WASBA can't do that, but they can do the big overall perspective. We've had that done a couple of years ago as well.
In a little while, yeah.
Have to see how that goes.
Okay. Please let me know so I can have direction.
Mr. Thompson.
Well, my request is not just clarification of the 20% and where do we have the wiggle room, whatever. But at some point, this board has got to decide, as we come in and pull in more revenues, is the board's priority going to be, number one, a salary increase? Number two, is it going to be for the five-year restoration plan? And at some point, we need to have dialogue and consensus there, and I don't have a clue where the rest of you are coming from. So my lighting the fire in the 20% is not just for myself, but we need to see the wiggle room there. We've already talked about additional revenues, which are not showing up here, and the ultimate goal is we need to say to administration of the several things up there that are unfunded, this is where we want to put our marbles.
Sure, and I always appreciate
that's where I'm coming from ultimately.
And so, I always appreciate that information. We will bring a recommendation. Administration will bring a recommendation to you as to if we have to reduce the budget, where those reductions will need to be made.
Commissioner Soderman.
It's been 10 years for Kevin and I, and I think that, you know, we've gone through this, lived this many times, but I very much back that idea of Keith going through items so you understand where utility expenses have been, paperclip supplies per student, you know, fees for everything from construction paper to whatever, that those numbers are laid out, that we understand those, because some of those things are harder to change. You can't turn the heat off, and at least we shouldn't. So
we shouldn't.
I think it would be very helpful for that to be done. And I, you know, we have the benefit, Kevin and I have all these years, but others of you do not. And I think that would be a great refresher course to have. And I would even go again just to go. So I think it'd be a great idea to get the board up to speed on those things.
And I can find the place where we can bring Jeep back and look at that as well. Okay.
Other future board agenda
items?
Commissioner Soderman.
Hey, normally when people have the chance to, you know, go to a convention, whatever, they come back with a report of what they've done. And so I'd like to maybe get an update on what the members who went to D.C. did some type in a future meeting to report back. Thanks.
We have a couple of those, D.C., and I think there is a another group went somewhere that we haven't, so. So, yeah.
Okay, any other? Okay, seeing none, we have reached the end of our agenda. We are adjourned.
Yeah.